Kumar board session, and our faculty today are Dr. Professor Dr. Omita Maheshwari. Dr. Omita Maheshwari, she is the professor and head department of gynecological oncology, Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Shojusri T. Shurupa, she is professor and senior consultant, gynecological oncology, Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Sushil Kumar Giri, Sushil Kumar Giri sir, she is the honorary professor, PG Department of Gynecological Oncology, ASPGIC, Chutok. Dr. Shima Guria is professor, Department of Medical Oncology, Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai. I request our president of the Oncology Club to give us permission for formal starting the meeting.
Please go on and start. Andriy Asin Asin, question Asin.
Meeting Giri Sir Asin, Aguayat President Vijay Ahuja Sir Asin, Maheshwari Madam Asin Nai.
Let's start. That is already parking.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Before we start our original session, on a regular basis, we start our poll questions. And I request Fatima Shorna to show the poll question, please. Shorna, poll question. Yes. And the, each question, you will get, at first time, you will get the 40 seconds. And at the end of the session, we'll again give you the poll questions, and then you get 30 seconds. And the among the all the participants are requested for poll voting, and among all, three winners will be selected.
Polling has ended.
Swapna, please stop the whole screen.
Ma'am, it's already stopped.
Okay. Thank you very much. Our first presenter today is Dr. Fardana Islam Bithi. Dr. Fardana Islam Bithi, she is the registrar from Gynae and resident Gynae Oncology Department in National Institute of Cancer Research and Hospital. I request Dr. Fardana Islam Bithi to present your case.
Madam, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
Can share, Karun.
Is my screen visible?
Yes.
No. No. All right.
Respected home and foreign faculties of Oncology Club and learning audience, Assalamu alaikum and very good evening. This is Dr. Fardana Islam Bithi, resident gynecological oncology, National Institute of Cancer Research and Hospital, Noakhali, Dhaka. Going to present my case. Mrs. X, 30 years, nulliparous, housewife of a lower income group family, underwent a laparotomy followed by ovarian cystectomy on 9th April 2019 outside Dhaka in a private clinic suspected in a case of ovarian cyst. Before cystectomy, only the CA125 result revealed 98 units per ml and CA199 result revealed 36 units per ml. That time, ultrasonogram of the whole abdomen was shows a large multiseptic mass in the lower abdomen extending up to the epigastrium. Size could not be measured. Pulse of Douglas is free. Histopathology report was not done. As the patient is 30 years, could any other tumor marker or germ cell marker be done in this age group?
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. So what you like to do in this particular case of 30 years old with a large mass, what you like to do in this particular case? What are the other markers you like to do?
Other marker, I like to do the germ cell marker, LDAs, serum beta HCG.
Anything else?
Carcinoembryonic embryonic antigen.
It is not that much required. Anything else? To rule out Yuk-Sec tumor?
Yes, sir.
So you should go for AFP, alpha beta protein, okay?
Yes, sir.
You could have gone for alpha beta protein in particular case, so that at least your total tumor marker is now complete because it's 30 years only. So you could have gone for this. Perhaps you should go for this. And in the meanwhile, there is a little bit of CA, that is CA125 is a little high. And your CA19. Why did you go for CA19.9?
Sir, this case is this report done outside the National Institute.
No problem. So okay. Then what you have done? You have done any other markers?
Go to your next slide. Other markers. What did you did? Yeah. Fardana,
ma'am, you are mute.
Madam, she is mute.
Yes. Patient was all right 1.5 year. After that, she again developed large abdominal pelvic mass and lower abdominal pain. For this complaint, she attended her physician 6 October 2020. That time, ultrasound of the whole abdomen was done, which revealed a large cystic lesion with multi-septate noted in the pelvic cavity and extending up to the epigastric region. The origin could not be identified. That time, C125-161 and CA99, more than 1,000 units per ml. And also done outside the National Institute, FNAC, ultrasonographic FNAC was done, and report revealed papillary mucinous cystic neoplasm, possibly malignant.
So what should have been done? This particular, what should have been done? Because it was done outside your hospital.
Yes,
so what is the ideal?
How should we proceed with this patient?
Now it becomes difficult. Now it is already FNAC done. So again, you should proceed. Yes, you can proceed with further investigations and
with this finding.
Other imagings. Yes, other imaging you should do.
Yes, these findings, patient was referred to National Institute of Cancer Research and Hospital Mohakhali, Dhaka. In our outpatient department, we found a large abdominal pelvic mass. She had no bowel and bladder habit alteration. She had no family history of breast, ovarian, and colon cancer. On general examination, her ECOG performance status 1, mildly anemic, cachexic, BMI 16, no accessible lymphadenopathy. On parabdominal examination, huge abdominal pelvic mass occupying the whole abdomen. Surface is irregular, solid, and cystic in nature with restricted mobility. On paraspeculum examination, cervix apparently healthy looking. On bimanual examination, mass failed through the anterior fornix, seems to be adherent to the bladder wall. On rectovaginal examination, no nodule in the pouch of Douglas, and digital rectal examination revealed rectal mucus free. So we done the X-ray chest, posterior anterior view, endoscopy, and colonoscopy, which report is normal. And also done CT scan of the whole abdomen, which shows a fairly large cystic mass measuring about 21.3 into 18.9 centimeter, having internal septation is seen in the abdominal pelvic cavity. The mass displaced bowel loops periphery. Inferiorly, the mass indent the urinary bladder and compress the uterus. Posteriorly, it about in the anterior rectal wall. Vertically, it extends from lumbar 1 to sacral 3.
You are muted.
Absent right kidney and left kidney is relatively large in size and moderate hydroureteronephrosis. No parotic and mesenteric lymphadenopathy, no ascites is seen. So, we done in IVU, and IVU result shows non-visualization of the right kidney and moderate hydroureteronephrosis on the left kidney. For this reason, we referred the patient uro-oncology, and their decision was urinary diversion in the form of DJ stenting done on 4 November 2020. After that, she underwent laparotomy on 17 November 2020 in our institute. And paroportic findings, huge multi-located cystic mass is seen, must extend in the lower abdomen to the upper abdomen. GERD, large GERD and small GERD adherent at different parts of the cystic mass. Rectum also adherent at the base. Site of the origin of the cyst could not be identified, and it was densely adherent to the fundus of the uterus. Both fallopian tubes and ovaries could not be identified separately. During removal of the cyst, it was ruptured and 5 to 6 liter mucinous material came out. No deposit under surface of liver and other abdominal organ was found. Then total abdominal hysterectomy with removal of the abdominal mass with total omentectomy with appendicectomy was done. Figo surgical staging C1C1. This is the perioperative tumor picture. Must extend from the lower abdomen to the upper epigastrium. Is there any role of fertility sparing surgery in this case, sir?
It is difficult to say because you are not able to know the origin. But if you say from which, whether it is come from the ovary or other places, the other one, we do not know the status of the other ovary. If it comes from one ovary, the other ovary status is not known. So again, it was so extensive disease. Yes. And we have not gone for the presence section particular case. Because you could have gone for presence section because if it is a mucinous carcinoma, a mucinous tumor, we do not know. It might be a benign one and it has recurred after 1 year and somebody has done some surgery, which maybe it might not have been done, the complete surgery might not have been done. And it is, we do not know whether it is a malignant. By now, we do not know if it is malignant or benign. Okay.
Sir, patient has a tissue diagnosis, FNAC, which shows...
Tissue diagnosis shows it is a mucinous tumor. Malignancy cannot be excluded. Think of that.
Yes.
Tissue diagnosis was like that. So it was FNAC diagnosis was there, not tissue diagnosis. It is cytology. So you could have gone for this particular case. We could have gone for a present section if it is available, or if not available, we could have gone for this some imprint smear. But it may not be 100%. You cannot get diagnosis, but you can get some clue that yes, I am dealing with malignancy here. This is my opinion. Dr. Ahuja, if you are there, you can just put some input into it. Dr. Ahuja.
Yes, like Dr. Omita Moheshwari.
Good evening. Thank you, Dr. Giri.
Yeah,
most of what I agree with Dr. Giri, but I just want to make one comment that a couple of comments before I come to this, because when Dr. Fadana was describing the case, in her findings, she had mentioned that anterior fornix bladder appears to be adherent. So that finding, I just don't know how you can identify that on a clinical examination. You have to just say that the mass has fell there or whether the mass is infiltrating the vagina. That is the only thing you can feel. You can never comment on bladder adherence on a vaginal examination. And this is for the benefit of students. The second thing, when you say that a urinary diversion was done, that is not a diversion. Diversion is when you're altering the course of the urine flow. Here you're maintaining the same anatomy, so you're relieving the pressure, you're doing a stenting. So you don't mention it as a diversion. Diversion means you're changing the anatomy, the urine is going to flow from somewhere else. Now coming to this case, when you say that on ultrasound it was ovaries were not identified, but when you open and when you start dissecting, then you have to see whether you can see an ovary during your dissection. Any part of normal ovarian tissue is seen or not seen. Frozen section would have been an ideal, but the problem with large tumors is that you cannot sample adequately. You may have a false negative frozen section and mucinous tumors, it is difficult. But generally what the principle is, whenever there is a fertility sparing surgery planned, when there's a woman desirous of fertility, you have to explain to the woman that we will do a fertility sparing surgery based on the findings. The tumor should be limited to the ovary and there should be no obvious evidence of malignancy. If you have a frozen also, you have to tell the patient that a frozen may be negative. If it is malignant, you may need a second surgery. So in those cases, we always do a fertility sparing surgery when there is a borderline, when there's no advanced disease seen. And our opinion, we cannot be sure that it is borderline or not borderline. Because fertility cannot be given back, but we can always operate again. So that the woman, if there is, she's agreeing, then we go for a fertility sparing, provided the tumor is limited to an ovary. Even if it is a 1C, a borderline, you still do a fertility sparing. So that has to be cleared out. But during dissection, normally when you're doing with a large tumor also, you will ultimately reach an ovary hanging in one side or part of at the lower part of the capsule, you can see some ovarian tissue. So that is the only thing I can add now. Yeah, back to you.
Pinisapti is not a master.
She is muted.
Yeah. Ah, she is muted most probably. Yeah. Parjana, you unmute yourself.
Parjana.
Yes, sir. Yes, madam.
Okay.
Whether so, appendicectomy is a must in normal-looking appendix of ovarian mucinous carcinoma?
It is not a must.
Yes.
But it is mucinous carcinoma. If you are dealing with, we may remove, but there is it is not a must. It is not mandatory. Yeah.
Next. Parjana, next.
Whether lymphadenectomy is mandatory in this case, sir?
In carcinoma, we are not. I am not sure whether we are dealing with carcinoma or borderline or something like that. But in any way, the mucinous carcinoma lymphadenectomy is not required. Unless it is infiltrative variety, again we do not know what is infiltrative or what is expansile. But in a mucinous carcinoma or mucinous carcinoma, lymphadenectomy is not required, not recommended at all. So there is no need of doing lymphadenectomy in mucinous carcinoma because lymph nodes are rarely involved.
Arjana.
Her histopathology report shows both ovaries papillary mucinous cyst adenocarcinoma stage 1B N0MX while proliferative phase cervix chronic cervicitis omental lymph node reactive change and vermiform appendix shows follicular hyperplasia.
So what you did in this particular case?
Any role of molecular testing here, sir?
Yes, we can go for other testing should have been done, and but with this histopathological testing, what is your plan?
What is your plan, Parjana? Your plan?
My plan is adjuvant therapy.
Which adjuvant?
Patient goes to the tumor board and adjuvant therapy.
Which adjuvant like to give? Which drug you like to give?
Sir, paclitaxel and carboplatin.
Is that effective?
Madam, am I audible?
Yes, you are.
I mean to say, I like to ask you, is there an indication of giving chemotherapy in particular case?
Sir, in case of mucinous carcinoma, chemotherapy is not so much effective.
And what is the indication here?
So, sir, we proceed role of any molecular testing here.
Yes, you like to say, you can say what you like to do.
Madam, Shana, madam.
What molecular testing you like to do, and what the purpose behind it?
Hello. Hello, madam.
Madam is muted. So, Amita is there? Amita can add something. Dr. Amita. Dr. Bijoy, Dr. Ahuja.
Sorry, yeah. My connection had gone in between. I missed out. What's that?
Okay. So, what about the molecular testing and what is the indication of chemotherapy in particular case? What chemotherapy would you like to give? Her question is there. I told it is chemotherapy. I do not know what is the indication of chemotherapy in particular case and what chemotherapy would you like to give. And if there is a role of any molecular testing.
Yeah, see, molecular testing, basically, the histology is clear. I don't think it will add. But it would be better for a pathologist to answer. But the main thing is that this is a bilateral mucinous, which is quite rare. Usually bilateral and metastatic, and we don't have any initial CEA also. And regarding the GI testing, whether anything was there. So a pathologist will have to differentiate between a primary or a metastatic mucinous tumor. So that question remains because a bilateral is a very rare entity.
Sir, how can we differentiate primary mucinous or from the metastatic mucinous?
Yeah, so the pathologist will have to do where CK7, CK20 and testing. Yes, but generally, you have a CEA done, and if the CEA is usually elevated in the beginning, it's elevated for mucinous tumors also and colorectal. So bilateral, I would always do a colonoscopy and rule out any GI pathology. Upper and lower GI endoscopy should be done. Whenever there's a bilateral mucinous malignancy.
Yeah, here they have done colonoscopy. The colonoscopy is done. They have done CT scan. Upper GI they have not done, but colonoscopy done. It was normal. Okay. But question comes, if it is bilateral, they have not done, I don't know, they have not done CEA at all. But what is the indication of doing CA 19.9 in this particular case?
19.9 is again elevated in mucinous tumors, even in ovary.
But it is more than 1,000.
Yes, sir, more than 1,000.
Yes, you should look into it. We should look into suspicion. It might be a primary from elsewhere, from pancreas. No. So, but CA they have not done. They should have gone for a CA examinations. However, with the bilateral ovarian tumor.
Sir, CA also done and report was normal, 2.17.
Okay. So most probably primary might be pancreatic. Who knows? Because 19.9 is quite high. Normally is around 37. And 19.9 is a quite high number. So we do not know. We have to exclude the pancreatic primary also. And regarding bilaterality of the tumor, yes, we should the suspicion in mind that it might be a secondary. But secondary tumors are usually mobile. And it is adherent because of most probably because of previous surgery. So anyhow, as Dr. Ahuja told that we should go for some markers to rule out whether it is a primary or secondary.
But anyway, there will be an indication for adjuvant therapy because she is already capsule ruptured and there is a need. I think the other expert faculty, I think, Dr. Amita's entering.
Amita can add something.
Yes, she's present. Amita Mohanshree, ma'am, she's here.
Oh, no. Yeah, hi, very interesting discussion. So I agree with whatever has been said, but we also have seen raised CA19-9 in primary mucinous tumors of ovary, especially in young girls. So if on CT scan pancreas was normal and on clinical examination also if it was normal, I think we would consider it as primary ovarian mucinous tumor.
Madam, what will be her adjuvant treatment?
I missed actually most of it because of cyclone yesterday. Our internet connection is not good. So I actually couldn't attend major part of the case discussion, case presentation.
See the case of mucinous carcinoma of the ovary, bilateral mucinous carcinoma ovary now with after histopathology. And it is at least it's one C1
bilateral mucinous tumor.
Yeah.
Okay, and did we do upper GI endoscopy as well?
Yes, madam. Endoscopy and colonoscopy revealed normal.
And gallbladder and pancreas intraoperatively normal because
intraoperatively gallbladder distended, pancreas normal.
Okay, because primary bilateral is extremely rare. And if it is, and have you done IHC in terms of CK7, CK20 and CDX2 markers, no. Histochemistry marker?
We have advice for that. Parjana, have you advised for this?
No, madam.
Okay. So it is 1B disease. And could your pathologist tell about the grade of tumor? Of course, mucinous, they find it difficult to grade mucinous tumors.
Yes.
At times, they, if especially poorly differentiated, they are able to tell that. So do we know the grade?
No, madam. Histopathology report, there is not mentioned the grade of the tumor. The only says the 1B1.
1B, not
1B. 1B.
Nothing like 1B1. Okay. 1B, I mean, if it is stage 1B, low grade mucinous tumor.
No, it is not 1B. The capsule ruptured. No?
Yeah, it is 1C1 it was.
It is this is actually 1C1 on parapetic, it was ruptured.
Okay. So if it is, if you are treating, you know, without IHC, it will be very difficult. But if we consider it as primary ovarian mucinous tumor, we still give paclitaxel as first line of chemotherapy, although we know that it may not be the best. But our first line is still paclitaxel and carboplatin. But I think in this case, immunohistochemistry is extremely important
yes,
to get some idea. But if you are considering it as primary ovarian mucinous tumor, then our protocol would be paclicarbo as first line. We may consider FOLFOX as second line. And Dr. Giri and Dr. Ahuja, what do you
do? Yes. And whatever you give, the paclicarbo is not sensitive at all.
Right.
Yes. So in the mucinous carcinoma, this chemotherapy, which you give in other ovarian malignancies, that's a serious papillary serous carcinoma is not effective at all. And there is a dictum, the mucinous carcinoma which requires chemotherapy, it has worst prognosis.
Right. So the thing is, do you give some other chemotherapy?
Yeah, we don't give. Falpox, again, they have tried Falpox, it is not at all effective at all.
So if it is 1C1,
we have to give. Do you give any adjuvant
or no?
Yes. That is a role of adjuvant here. We have.
Madam, if there is any relapse, what will be the further treatment?
So anyway, we were on the, okay, so the further treatment would depend upon the site of relapse, duration of relapse, how much is disease-free interval. So mucinous ovarian tumor, maybe if it is a longer disease-free interval, I guess she's a young patient. And if it is surgically resectable, we would consider surgery. And generally, these mucinous tumors, they relapse as pseudomyxoma peritoni. So in that case, I think we would consider surgery and plus minus HIPEC and adjuvant chemotherapy. Or if it is not a resectable disease, then we will give palliative chemotherapy.
Is there any role of bevacizumab?
Bev in mucinous, there is, I don't think there is any specific data, but
there is something they use this. Yeah, bevacizumab in ESGO conference, they consulted with this bevacizumab.
Bev doesn't work anywhere, actually. It works everywhere and it actually doesn't work anywhere. So, including COVID.
Is there any role of capecitabine?
Yeah, capecitabine, that's what we were discussing. So GI protocols we do use. We have given capecitabine to a couple of our patients, but response is moderate, not dramatic, but some of them do respond to capecitabine. Dr. Ahuja, what is your practice?
Yeah, see. In recurring settings, yes, docetaxel capecitabine repertoire adjuvant as far as not very common. Whatever mucinous we see very early or borderline. But as an adjuvant, as you said, first line paclicarbo has usually been given. But in salvage setting, yes, it is given. Regarding bevacizumab, I don't know if you can club it with the platinum resistant group. If it comes in that platinum resistant group, then bevacizumab may have a role. Other than that, I think most of the thing what you say, I agree to that.
unmute.
Thank you. Thank you, madam.
Thank you.
Stop your screen sharing. Pardon, please. Farzana, yes. Thank you, Dr. Farzana Islam, for your presentation. Now I request Dr. Rukhsana Parveen. She is resident gynae oncology, National Institute of Cancer Research and Hospital, to present her piece. Dr. Rukhsana Parveen.
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, can I start?
Yes.
Honorable Chairperson, respected home and foreign faculties of Oncology Club and learned audience, Assalamu Alaikum. My patient is a 50 years menopausal hypertensive diabetic lady. 2 years back, she attended to a local hospital with the complaints of feeling of an abdominal lump with diffuse and dull-aching pain. Her ultrasonogram report revealed fibroid uterus with adnexial mass. She underwent
Your skin.
I have shared my screen.
We are not seeing. We are not visible.
Okay. My share is visible now.
Yes.
My slide is visible now, sir.
Make it a full screen. Okay. Make it a full screen. I just look now.
Okay, sir. My patient is a 50 years menopausal hypertensive diabetic lady, attended to a local hospital with the complaints of feeling of an abdominal lump with diffuse and dull aching pain. Her ultrasonogram report revealed fibroid uterus with adnexial mass. And she underwent laparotomy followed by total abdominal hysterectomy and right-sided salpingoporectomy on 17th July 2019. But in her operation note, her operative findings were not mentioned and no histopathology was done. On July 2020, patient first time came to our hospital with abdominal mass and lower abdominal pain. At that time, patient's ECOG score was 2 and she was severely anemic. Beside this, all other vitals were within normal limit. Parabdominally, a 15 x 20 cm large, mostly solid, partly cystic, fixed mass was present, occupying whole of the lower abdomen. Vault looks apparently healthy. CA125 was 600 units per ml, but CA99 was within normal limit. This is the CT scan images and report of this patient showing multiple large mixed density enhancing lesion measuring about 11 x 10 cm. Are seen superior to urinary bladder and also in cul-de-sac region. Lesion extend to right parietal wall. Now, how will you proceed with this patient? Professor Amita Mishra, ma'am.
Yeah, hi. Good evening. So you said it's a fixed mass, apparently, like, you know, you can't resect it surgically and we don't have biopsy details of the first surgery. So we will do ultrasound guided biopsy of this mass.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. We have done 4 biopsy from the pelvic mass and the report was papillary adenocarcinoma. Now, what will be our treatment plan, ma'am?
So we will, because it was at least clinically fixed pelvic mass, non-resectable, I guess, like, I don't know exactly, but if that is the case, we will give neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you. According to our tumor board decision, 3-cycle chemotherapy with paclitaxel and carboplatin was given up to 23rd September 2020. And after her completion of 3-cycle chemotherapy, during evaluation of this patient, a polypoid mass about 3 x 4 cm was detected, which was protruding through the center of the vault. biopsy was taken from the bald mass, and histopathology report of that mass revealed metastatic papillary adenocarcinoma. And at that time, her C125 was 268 unit per ml. This is the sagittal view CT scan of this patient, showing enhancing a soft tissue mass about 6 into 5 centimeters in anterior part of the lower abdomen, which is adjacent to the bowel loop. And there was another soft tissue enhancing mass about 4 into 3 centimeters at the vault area, which was protruding to the pelvic cavity. Up to this scenario, we have shown that before 3-cycle chemotherapy, our lesion, the diameter of the lesion was 11 into 10 centimeter, and tumor marker was C125, that is C125 tumor marker was 600 unit per ml. And after 3-cycle chemotherapy, the diameter of the lesion reduced to 5 to 6 centimeter, and the tumor marker also reduced to 268 unit per ml. So at this scenario, ma'am, how we considered this situation, as it is partial response or progressive disease?
No, definitely a partial response, not progressive disease. She has, both in terms of CT scan and CA125, there is response. So it will we'll categorize it as partial response.
There is a new lesion involved.
So there is a possibility, because that initial mass was quite big. There is a possibility. There are two possibilities. One, that what we reported as big mass, there were 2-3 masses which were seen as one. The other possibility is it was missed because of large big mass. So I would not consider it as progressive disease.
I have a question. Can I just ask? Yeah. See, she had an initial surgery for a fibroid uterus, and this was getting confused. She had the initial surgery elsewhere for what?
For uterine mass.
Uterine mass with
initial mass.
She did not have a histopathology then. Possibly there could be a uterine adenocarcinoma also, which has a vault relapse. That may not, get cleared off with chemotherapy, and then you have this ovarian cancer which is responding. That is the possibility. But your clinical examination now should tell you whether there is any induration around the vagina and all that. So
no, sir.
So that is one. I don't know, Dr. Amita.
I think what now she is mentioning, there was some ovarian mass also at that time.
Yeah, both. It could be double. Both. Concurrent.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So okay. That's why you can explain a partial response and, a new lesion there.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Then she received 3-cycle change schedule chemotherapy with injection ifosfamide, injection cisplatin. After completion of her 3-cycle change schedule chemotherapy, on our evaluation, her ECOG score was 0. All vital parameters were normal. Parabdominally, no abnormality was detected. On pelvic examination, a soft tissue mass about 1.5 into 1 centimeter present in vault. No nodule in pouch of Douglas. And at that time, her C125 was 48 unit per ml. What will be our management plan now? Bhagyalakshmi, ma'am. Ma'am, please.
See here.
Professor Sushil Kumar Giri, sir.
Nandi, before giving the second line chemotherapy, is there any contraindication doing surgery at that particular time? Because if it was a partial responsive with a vault mass coming out, so you could have gone for the surgery at that time also. However, after giving the second line chemotherapy, now this is the time we should intervene here with surgery. Surgery has to be done in a particular case. and perhaps we can give the best result out of that.
I agree with Dr. Giri. The only question I have, you have given a second line I-phosphamide. We generally don't use this regimen at all. So any particular reason? Is this the second line chemotherapy in at your center?
Partial response.
No, that is okay. But if we have to give, we generally change to either Lipodox or gemcitabine-based chemotherapy along with platinum. Yes. We don't use I-phosphamide. I mean, I don't remember any time using I-phos as second-line chemotherapy for epithelial ovarian tumors.
So, Amita, before moving to I-phos, it is Kamal. Hi.
Yeah, hi.
My first question is, was there any need for the was there any need for chemo at that time? We could have gone for surgery. That is my first question.
Yes, that is possible. But considering someone thought that there could be new lesions, and also I was just looking at timeline, maybe it was COVID time. So maybe one would want to take, wanted little time. So
I was talking about the magic number, you know, the 3-cycle and 6-cycle.
Right. So, yeah, in fact, and what our policy is, if there is partial response, we continue same chemotherapy for maybe a couple of more cycles. The thought was it was it was labeled as progressive disease, and that's why it was changed to another kind of chemotherapy.
Yeah, but I totally agree with you. If we are convinced that it is a papillary adenocarcinoma coming from ovary, probably even I will not go for I-phosphamide. Maybe I will go for lipo or gem.
Yeah, but in this case, anyway, there was a response. So I don't know whether it was to PSS platin or IFOS. Yeah.
Platinum played the problem.
Right.
So, but the big problem, you know, here, what I anticipate, that this type of thing, it is lucky that there is a good response, but this type of patient may become frail with this platinum and IFOS, very too toxic drug. So maybe a patient may
applied in hospital, probably. I don't know.
I'm discussing for our colleague that if this type of patient, our next target is to do a surgery. So we need to keep that in mind. So if we give a very toxic chemotherapy and patient goes down, then patient may lose the fitness of surgery. That may become a challenge. That is just a discussion that I'm bringing.
Magic is next.
Yeah, next is surgery, I think, if she's fit to undergo surgery. We all agree on that point that we will offer her a surgery.
It was her MRI images and report of this patient at that time showing lobulated soft tissue intensity mass measuring about 5 × 2.2 mm is noted in bald region, suggestive of residual or recurrent mass involved. On 22nd March 2021, interval debulking surgery was done. Her operative findings, there was a 6 × 8 cm growth in sigmoid colon, which was adherent with growth in ileum. A small deposit found in vault area, no ascites, no metastasis in other abdominal pelvic organs. Resection of sigmoid colon growth and anastomosis was done. Growth of vaginal vault was removed with upper vaginectomy. Then the growth adherent with the ileum was resected and ileostomy was done. This is our histopathology report, which showed on colonic growth and vault tissue, both are metastatic papillary adenocarcinoma. Resection margins were free of tumor. Now, ma'am, what will be further management plan of this patient?
So we will give her adjuvant chemotherapy. Now the question is, what do we give? Do we give? We will definitely give her platinum, maybe 2 to 3 courses based how, you know, if her condition is good, if she can tolerate, then we'll give platinum based chemotherapy.
Next, how will you follow up this patient? How will you proceed to follow up this patient?
So follow up is the standard every 3 to 4 monthly clinical examination, CA125, because it was elevated initially. And we do not do CT scan at every visit. We prefer doing ultrasound if markers are raised or if symptomatic or if clinical examination reveals anything, then only we do CT scan.
Okay.
That's our protocol. We don't do CT scan and X-ray chest on every visit.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Do you need maintenance therapy for this patient?
We generally don't give maintenance therapy. The only thing I think one can consider is if BRCA testing, I mean, that's beyond discussion here. PARP inhibitors, I think that's the only effective maintenance therapy, I think, in current time.
Thank you, ma'am.
There is a question. Can we go for chemistry if there is a partial response or when we should consider in this patient for immunohistochemistry, not immunohistochemistry, immunohistochemistry, IHC.
If there is partial response on IHC, then also we will give adjuvant therapy.
No. Their question is, shall we consider, Dr. Ahuja was telling that the origin is ovary, I mean, in partial response, shall we go for IHC to differentiate whether it is coming from endometrium or ovary, or we'll be happy with the partial response?
Okay. I think it's a good idea if we can have the origin known. I mean, it's a good idea, but it was papillary adenocarcinoma. So, yes, I mean, if we have IHC facility and if we can do, but the only thing is, I don't know whether pathologists will be able to differentiate between papillary ovary and papillary endometrium provided. I mean, unless they do the entire panel of immunohistochemistry.
You have to do
P53, but WT1 and PAX8 and other markers to know whether it's primary ovary or primary endometrium, serous carcinoma, papillary adenocarcinoma.
There was a question whether you're going to revise your diagnosis when there is no response or partial response. The only thing we need to have a revised diagnosis by doing again core biopsy and ISC of the particular tissue. Perhaps we could have done that. But perhaps we should go for a surgery. We could have gone for surgery in the first instant. After first 3 cycle chemotherapy, when you're thinking this partial response, we could have gone the surgery particular case. Then we could have got all the informations out of that.
I just want to make one comment.
Yes, Ahuja.
Yes, Dr. Ahuja.
Yeah, one comment can I make then?
Yes, yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Hello.
There's
a question. The discussion was there about this possibility of coexisting uterine synchronous malignancy. The adjuvant therapy obviously will not change, as Dr. Amita said. Any response means you continue with the platinum-based chemotherapy. The only thing that would have been added would have been brachytherapy there if coexistent uterine primary was there on your IHC and immunocytochemistry. The other thing is, I don't know, I just happened to see the other slide that was also showing ifosfamide, so I was again confused.
Usana, go on. Yes. All in? Usana?
Proceed. Usana,
proceed. Yes.
Sorry, ma'am. Next slide. Oh, okay, sir. Adjuvant chemotherapy was started from 21st April 2021 with ifosfamide, mesna, and cisplatin. And her last C125 was 17.38 unit per ml. Only one cycle chemotherapy yet she had taken. She has taken.
So how many cycles do you plan to give now?
Ma'am, 3 cycles.
Okay. Excellent. Okay.
Ma'am, thank you for presence and patience hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rukhsana, and all the faculties for your discussion. Now, our third presenter is Dr. Sushmita.
Yes,
Sushmita Sarkar, and I request Dr. Sushmita Sarkar to present your case. Hi. Here is first slide. Sushmita.
Am I audible?
Yes.
I don't see my slides.
Yes.
So she is a 27 years lady trying to conceive for 11 years. Recently on transabdominal ultrasound, bilateral complex abdominopelvic mass was detected. She was then underwent laparoscopy on 8th April of this year without any tumor marker. Her surgeon reported both of her tube ovaries were buried in pouch of Douglas and adherent with sigmoid. And during adhesiolysis, there was huge bleeding and she needed 6 units of blood paraoperatively. So she was diagnosed stage 4 pelvic endometriosis and right ovarian tissue was taken for biopsy. So how to select ovarian masses for laparoscopy? Amita madam.
So I think in itself is a, you know, going to be a lecture, but essentially a pre-operative workup is required in terms of both imaging and tumor markers. Now in this case, I don't know what imaging was done. Was it ultrasound? Was it the MRI or CT scan? And what were findings? So having just, you know, essentially important that radiologists give detailed on imaging, whichever one is done, and give their impression whether it's likely to be malignant or benign, or, you know, whatever criteria IOTA or whichever they use. So that is one, and tumor markers. So in this young lady, we need to do germ cell markers as well as epithelial markers. So pre-operative impression is that mass is likely to be benign, then only one should go for laparoscopic surgery, and especially size of the mass is another important factor. So if it's a big mass, which you think cannot come out intact in an endo bag, then again, I think open surgery is better. Now she had bilateral masses. I don't know whether on ultrasound they were complex or benign, I mean, cystic. And tumor markers were also not done. So in this case, of course, definitely it was not completely evaluated preoperatively. And Saman, the other thing is, even if you have decided, not in this case, but even if you have decided to do laparoscopy, if intraoperatively you feel that it's not any of known benign pathologies, I think it's best either to abandon surgery without, doing morcellation, puncture, rupture, or convert to open surgery. Of course, a prior consent is required from the patient, as well as open surgery, and have frozen section facilities available if possible.
I like to add some here that one should have gone for the IOTA.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yes, IOTA, yes, whatever IOTA, they yes, follow.
They should have gone for it.
Yeah, but there's no findings available, yeah, actually. Yeah, there's nothing.
Yeah.
So bilaterality in itself is like highly suspicious thing. Of course, wherein endometriosis can be bilateral.
Yeah.
Endometriosis can be bilateral, but one has to have a proper imaging findings. So.
And especially with infertility. So that should be the first diagnosis.
Right.
Clinically, we could have guessed something. Yes, clinical examination should have been done before laparoscopy. Then all the imaging procedures, and IOTA can guide that. Yes, I'm dealing with malignant or benign one.
Perhaps. Yeah, I think ultrasound is the first step that give character of the mass. Is it a largely solid mass, solid cystic? What is the vascularity of the mass? So all those factors are extremely important.
Should I proceed?
Yeah, please.
So on histopathology report, right ovarian tissue revealed this dysgerminoma. She was referred to our hospital as dysgerminoma with pelvic endometriosis. On general examination, her ECOG was 1, vitals were normal. On parabdominal examination, a tender firm mass in the lower abdomen, parvaginally a solid cystic mass impacted in pouch of ductus around 10 to 12 centimeter. Regarding her tumor markers, C125 was raised and other germ cell tumor markers were within normal limit.
LDH was elevated, 373.
CT scan of whole abdomen revealed lobulated mass arising from right ovary about 14 to 15 centimeters, and the mass was completely included in pouch of ductus. So, ma'am, she is a patient of subfertility with normal tumor markers, that is, germ cell tumor markers, almost normal, with a histopathology diagnosis of dysgerminoma. Should we consider Frogen in her staging laparotomy?
Not now. I mean, not required. We already have a diagnosis of dysgerminoma. But the only thing is we don't know about the other side mass. I mean, it would depend what we, are we thinking it could be bilateral dysgerminoma or it could be endometriosis on one side and dysgerminoma on the other side.
Giri sir?
Yes, I agree with Amita. So somehow we have to go laparotomy and on the table we should decide what we are going to do. Because we do not know the ovary and this ovary.
In this case, you know.
So we have to do surgery on that.
Right. So I would request primary surgeon to provide either video recording of the surgery or pictures or at least clinical findings, exactly what was it.
I think on gross examination also we will have little difference on the perioperative finding of which side would be dysgerminoma and which side would be the endometriosis.
I think one should again differentiate between dysgerminoma and endometriosis on gross also looking at the thing, I mean that's my personal impression. Of course I'm not very sure because dysgerminomas are more lobulated, solid, bosselated masses.
The looks are totally different from macroscopic look.
No, macro.
Should be, but yes, now we don't know because it has already been handled. So everything will be in a mess.
The other, of course, point of discussion here can be whether we would consider, now we have a diagnosis of dysgerminoma, whether we would consider neoadjuvant chemotherapy in this case. So she already had a surgery where she required some 6 units of blood transfusion. She got a rapidly increasing mass. So, and we know that these tumors are highly chemosensitive.
Why will you go for? We think that it is operable case and clinically also in.
No, I mean, no, just for the sake of discussion, we can have discussion on this, but.
Yes. Because we are concerned about the fertility sparing, that's the issue mainly. So we don't know which side is the endometriosis and which side is the dysgerminoma.
There may not be any endometriosis actually.
But endometriosis and dysgerminoma on imaging would be distinct. That will have to be more of a preoperative diagnosis rather than an interim diagnosis on cross. Because endometriosis will not have the same solid pattern like a dysgerminoma.
There may not be any endometriosis. It was just an impression of, that endometriosis.
No, but that diagnosis would come in preoperatively on imaging itself. Whether using all those IOTA and other things, it will clearly rule out endometriosis. So that confusion shouldn't be there when we open and see.
So the problem is that if one side is a dysgerminoma and the other side is endometriosis, that's the issue.
So I have a question here. Say if it was not an issue of fertility and there was a huge mass and this type of messy situation, will you be considering neoadjuvant adjuvant because we know.
Yeah, that's what I said. We might consider.
Is there any content? I mean, is there any? Normally, we see you do the surgery, then we do the chemo. But is there any harm? I mean, if you do a chemo.
No, I don't think there is any harm doing an ACT. Since we already have diagnosis in this case, although what Dr. Shana says is right, it's a operable disease apparently, but we could have considered neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And in our experience, of course, we gave two more advanced cases, but interestingly, in germ cell tumors, we see 70% pathological CR with neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
That's the issue.
Then you get confused. I had
some experience, not here, but non-semi-intermittent germ cell tumor. I mean, it was one to two response.
There is magic at the end of this.
Okay, so let's proceed. Let's wait for the magic.
Now, here, before going for the NACT, we should go for a surgery because surgery is amenable for surgery. So, surgery will give the better insight into the disease and you can plan accordingly. So after giving chemotherapy, things becomes very difficult to do surgery, and we may not get the primary pathology at all. Sometimes it gets dissolved also with chemotherapy. So that's the reason, in my opinion, we should have gone for surgery, and surgery should be done.
Yeah.
Because it's fertility sparing, so that is actually a little.
But if it's a discerned of bilateral discerned, even if you do primary surgery, the fertility surgery can be done. The larger surgery has larger tumor has to be removed, and the smaller tumor we can think of going for a removal of the tumor and ovary can be preserved. But if after chemotherapy, what happens? Everything now gone. We do not know where the smaller tumor might have dissolved. We do not know where it is. So perhaps primary surgery will give you the best insight into the disease, and then giving NACT. This is my opinion.
Sir, my only concern is that she already had some surgery where she needed 6 units of blood transfusion.
Leproscopy, they might be doing a lot of manipulation there. So there is bleeding. They might not have gone in a real plane. The whole problem lies there. Because thinking this to be endometriosis, they have gone in a different plane. That's why there is a bleeding. If it is a right plane surgery, bleeding would not have occurred. And open, you can go, really you can go for in the right plane. That's not the problem.
There is one aspect I would just like to add, that, you know, there is a possibility of a mixed germ cell tumor which would have a different prognosis. So if you give NACT, then you may miss out the chances of detecting a mixed germ cell tumor, which may be possible with a dysgerminoma. It mainly counts towards prognosis because the dysgerminoma obviously has very good prognosis, but it's mixed with a yolk sac tumor. It just gives you an idea. So that is one. And as Dr. Giri said, unless there is a metastatic disease or a very poor general condition, neoadjuvant chemotherapy, at least we have not been using in ovary confined disease.
Sushmita,
she then underwent surgical staging on 4th May. Paraoperative findings were a solid cystic mass about 18 into 15 centimeter arising from right ovary, adjuvant with uterus and ureter with invading gut wall. Mass was impacted in pouch of Douglas up to pelvic wall and sacrum, compressing right ureter. Left ovary was adjuvant with fallopian tube and gut. I would like to invite my mentor, Professor Shahana Madam, to share her experience during surgery. Would you please?
No, you please proceed, Sushmita.
Considering her fertility issue, and it was a dysgerminoma, so we go for right-sided self-infiltrate with omentectomy, with pelvic and paraortic lymph node sampling, with peritoneal biopsy.
But it is invaded gut wall. What you did to the gut wall?
Not invaded. Because that's invaded
It is you have described that it has invaded the gut wall. Just go back the other side. Go back.
And what about the left ovary?
Left ovary was healthy. Left ovary was healthy. Just left ovary tube. Then both were was adherent with the uterus and also the just nothing more than the, there was no cyst in left ovary.
Okay, okay, good.
So it is inverted, they got well. It is inverted or adherent? There are two terms.
Adherent. And serous layer is inverted, not inverted. Just adherent, not inverted. Yeah.
Right, adherent.
We leave a little on the gut wall, it doesn't matter too much. No, it's a germ cell tube. It's a germ cell tube.
I can resect it, there is no problem.
Okay. So her final histopathology report was clear cell carcinoma with pelvic and parotid lymph node with no malignancy. And madam, would you like to add something?
Yes, also clear cell carcinoma, with the, but there is the omentum metastasis again. Clear cell carcinoma with omental metastasis, one portion of the omental or metastasis. So what is her staging now? Would like to tell you it is stage 1C on. What is your comment?
She
had omental metastasis, no? Test 3D. Report, the histopathology report showing that it is a omental mass.
So,
how can dysgerminoma become clear cell? So, I have a doubt because sometimes yolk sac tumors may be confused with clear cell, but dysgerminoma is a totally different tumor. So, I don't know what was the issue with that. No, was it done in the same place, Dr. Shaman?
Yes, same place. We again review the slides.
Okay.
Review both slides and ultimately the final report was the clear cell carcinoma.
The previous report?
This is, sir. Yes, sir. This is the report. Yes.
Also clear cell carcinoma. The dysgerminoma which was there previously, also clear cell carcinoma?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Also, no, sir. It is clear cell carcinoma, not dysgerminoma.
Not dysgerminoma.
We have many times we have seen yolk sac tumors and frozen later they would come as clear cell carcinoma, but dysgerminoma we have never had dysgerminoma presenting as clear cell carcinoma later.
Previous diagnosis was clear cell carcinoma. The whole, it was clear cell carcinoma. Somehow it is mistakenly written as dysgerminoma. So now question comes: if it is a clear cell carcinoma now with the final diagnosis, the question of restaging comes. The question of revision of staging comes. What is your opinion, Amita, Dr. Ahuja? Amita is there?
So they have removed everything, parotid nodes, omentum, everything.
But other ovary is there.
Sparing cannot be done, yes.
But other ovary is there.
Yes.
The whole problem is other ovary is there.
So anyway, now stage 3 and then since you have an incomplete surgery, so you do something like NHCT and then go and do interval completion surgery.
No, sir. I don't like to tell it that stage 3C. I want to tell it that stage 1C on. Because
omental metastasis, you said histological proof of omental metastasis.
Sir, we have consulted to you with the histopathologist. His opinion is that the portion that as because the previously this laparoscopy was done and omentum was adherent with the mass and he doesn't want to tell it that it is the metastasis. His comment is just it is only the omental implant, not metastasis.
That is again another issue. So I think we'll need a pathologist to clarify that.
Yes, pathologist. I have consulted with pathologist that evening and she reviewed the slides and her comment is that portion. That portion of the omentum which was adherent and in that area only there was the deposit.
So finally, the disease is outside the pelvis. Okay.
No, sir.
She is telling Dr. Shana that
only the portion of the I understand that because the omentum is adherent to the ovarian mass, so it becomes positive. So whether there is an infiltration through ovary omentum or not, the question comes there. And second question comes once omentum is involved, whether it is implant or metastasis. So we should take just test 3 disease. What is Dr. Ahuja's opinion?
Yeah, once the disease is there in the omentum, especially it's clear cell carcinoma. It's very difficult to say differentiate metastasis, implant, and all that in this situation. We should go. What other alternate? We cannot treat it as you're saying as fertility sparing, if you want to say. it doesn't come in the classical indication of fertility sparing, a clear cell carcinoma with the spread outside the ovary. So either way you're treating as you have to treat it as a stage 3 clear cell carcinoma. Generally clear cell carcinoma beyond stage 1 and 2 have a very poor prognosis. So
it is 1C, 1A up to 1C on with adjuvant chemotherapy. In that cases, with or without, the prognosis is 5-year survival 80 to 90%. So can we not wait for this fertility sparing for this patient?
The problem is that we have to go by what is the concrete evidence. We are making an objective finding as subjective finding. So whether implant or metastasis he feels or they feel, that becomes subjective. What is there on the slide is objective. So if you have a metastasis, it's a metastasis. Very difficult to justify a metastasis.
Histopathologist comment, sir. Histopathologist comment. It is that that portions of the omentum which are adherent and that area, his comment is only the implant, not the metastasis.
Yes, Dr. Shana, but we really don't have any guidelines to tell that it will be a 1C if the omentum is adherent and positive. So omentum positive is stage 3 for us. So I think we have to...
Due to previous surgery, there was multiple injury in that area and their momentum was adherent. That may be the cause. I don't know what to then. How shall we
see? Yes. I understand
implant, that's a problem because everybody wants to go for the fertility sparing surgery.
The basic omental metastasis would start like that of implant coming into the omentum. But once it is on the omentum, it is going to draw out vessels and it is going to grow there. So it is already invading the tissues around there. So that is what you have to consider.
Actually, the problem is Dr. Shana wants to keep the ovary. So that is why she is trying to prove
fertility is another issue.
Yes, that's true. So in this particular case, you have to give a chemotherapy and give the total counseling that yes, we have already conserved the ovary and other tube for the purpose of fertility, but we don't know. We may have to go for a second surgery because there is a chance of recurrence. It is a clear cell carcinoma, though it is a type 1 ovarian malignancy. But we do not know as it has gone elsewhere.
Another thing is if you have the clear cell carcinoma with an extra spread, if you have to complete the staging, I mean if you have not done a complete omentectomy, lymph node sampling, I don't know what has been done. So stage is still a doubt.
No, sir. They have done complete periotic pelvic omentectomy.
They have done sampling.
Was written there.
They have done sampling only.
Okay.
No enlarged lymph node in preoperative imaging.
Not imaging, because you in a initial ovarian, early ovarian cancer staging, you have to do a lymph node dissection. So if a lymph node dissection is not done, that it becomes unknown lymph node status, and then you have an omental with this thing. There are a lot of gray areas now to tell the stage is less.
Yes, sir. There is also a lot of gray area for this complete lymphadenectomy or the lymph node sampling in that case also.
I think Shahana, what we are discussing here, that as she is looking for a fertility sparing, we are doing some wishful thinking. And yes, we are trying to justify that it was an implant, not a mets. But
yes,
as Dr. Ahuja said, I totally agree with him that the metastasis start as an implant. So by a sibling or an attachment, it first implant, then it invade. So looking at the implant, I mean, no pathologist cannot confirmly say that there is no further metastasis. So I want to go with them that even it is an attached area, we cannot say it 1C. I mean, it should be stage 3.
I think histopathologist is the main person who can comment on this.
Yeah, histopathologist also is making a wishful comment. You know, as Dr. Ahuja said, if you don't have all the information, all the samples, everything, and if you do something of everything, make a definite comment.
Can we not go for the adjuvant chemotherapy with describing everything and with discussing everything with the patient party, that there may be chance of recurrence, and during this time they can try for conception, if not, and everything okay, and the strict follow-up, and during otherwise they can, if there is the recurrence, then we can go for the completion surgery. Or shall we, what will we do? Will we go for the resurgery for this patient? What is your opinion?
Surgery is indicated, number one, resurgery, revision surgery. But yes.
What type of surgery, sir?
There is every role of going for the total hysterectomy. With we may not remove uterus, but you have to remove the other ovary, because there is chance that this ovary can become metastasis nest, and we have to go for the systematic pelvic and parotid lymphadenectomy up to renal vein, and total amantectomy, or you can go for a, but this, because amantectomy, you should be gone for a total amantectomy, because once amantectomy involved, total amantectomy is indicated.
But we have not done total amantectomy,
because in Dhizarna usually we do not do total amantectomy. We do not do amantectomy. You have done amantectomy because amantectomy is involved.
Also in Dhizarna, total lymphadenectomy, also peritoneal washing,
peritoneal biopsy. Not done. There is no need. Unless the tumor is more than 10 centimeters, sometimes people say unilateral lymphadenectomy can be done. But again, there is a lot of controversies. So usually it is not done. But it is 15 centimeter. But it is not always done. But however, you have done some lymphatic sampling, but it was not completely done in view of the revision diagnosis of clear cell carcinoma. So when clear cell carcinoma is there.
From here, sir. Shall we go for fertility preservation for this patient, or the second surgery followed by adjuvant chemotherapy?
No. When patient is very keen for fertility preservations, But here it is the end of the treatment now, but we will give some chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy should be given, and we should counsel the patient properly that we are trying, as you told earlier, then we can go for a counseling and try for pregnancy. But again, there is almost common chances of it coming back. That is coming back. It will come back, the disease, every possibility. That is the only thing. But again, you can take a chance looking into her fertility desire.
Can I add something?
Yeah, you can. Yeah.
No, if you go by Dr. Chahana's argument, just for argument's sake, I will give my opinion on what I would do here later. But if whenever you talk of a fertility sparing surgery now, generally, it is done in cases where you don't need adjuvant therapy. Now, you look at a practical problem. You have a probably, even if you say a 1C, you give adjuvant therapy. How long will you wait before you advise pregnancy? Because the relapses occur in 2 years. You will have to wait for 2 years before you allow a pregnancy, and then she gets pregnant, and that's the third year. If a relapse occurs during this time, a clear cell carcinoma relapse is basically a death sentence. It will not respond. The best chances are you catch it early, complete resection, and give adjuvant therapy. That's the only chance you have. So you have to think of all this. In this situation, the question is, I would tell the patient that the life is definitely more important than the fertility, giving all these facts, that any relapse is basically is not salvageable. The second thing, whether we should go immediately inside, we can give neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Since we have taken out the tumor, we are dealing only with microscopic disease. We can give chemotherapy either as a neoadjuvant, or we can give the complete 6-cycle set of stretch and do completion surgery at the end.
But if she asks you, sir, after doing all these things, am I not going to recur?
What I'm saying, we are giving the best chance now. I'm not saying it will not recur.
Without the chance of recurrence, is more than with.
Yeah. So you have to counsel in that way. That yes, chances are there, but doing surgery, chances are less. You can do that. Dr. Sahana.
Sir.
So you can decide what you're going to do.
Do you like to add anything,
Amalbhai? I want to agree with Dr. Ahuja, because this is a very valid issue, that for an emotional thing, wishful thinking, we go for preservation, but we cannot keep the patient without chemo. And yes, after chemo, at least 1.5 year, you need to wait. So, yes, and there is a every chance, 80% chance that it will recur. So I don't see a chance for any fertility preservation, at least in this patient. Even I wish I could say something to her. But I think here we can say that she has been waiting for long, and who said that there is a possibility of must fertility? She may not have. So all this, nothing goes in favor of fertility preservation. Life is more important than fertility. And yes, there is a chance of recurrence, obviously. But I mean, we don't want to be helpless with a recurrence rather than going for the first time treatment with the highest effort.
Do you think we could go ahead with some kind of IHC to confirm? Because both have been histopathological diagnosis.
We have already advised IHC.
Dr. Shahana, can I ask one question?
Yes.
Yeah, well, you have said the other ovary is quite normal looking.
Yes. So,
and as it is a stage 3, there is no doubt that we have to do the complete resection, because she is a stage 3, woman's life is more important. Nevertheless, I was just wondering if there's any venue to get the ovarian tissue from the other side, which was apparently looking healthy, and, you know, we can preserve that, and later on, you know, surrogation or something like that. Is there any scope for that? Thank you.
Shahana, I was just thinking of this, that since one ovary is good, so we can take out this ovary, can keep the ovarian tissue, can preserve the total ovary or ovarian cortex to get the follicle, or keeping his fertility later on. So we can keep this ovarian healthy ovary for cryopreservation, I think.
Exactly. That is our question.
I was also thinking of this. But in now you are removing the uterus, yes?
No, we didn't remove the uterus.
Now you will remove uterus? What's your plan?
The plan is if the faculty comments, they remove the uterus.
Yeah, there should be total removal, because this is a stage 3.
Yes.
Okay, then in that case, ovary, keeping the ovary, then making eggs and surrogating in other uterus, that can be done.
Shahana. It takes some time for oocyte preservation, that's all, or embryo preservation, because she's married.
In that case, yes. Now we will preserve the ovarian cortex, ovarian tissue, then we'll utilize this later on.
Professor Shati, we can't keep the ovary there.
No, we're removing the ovary, healthy ovary.
Exactly,
and
right.
We will cryopreserve that, and then we will think of how she can get be a biological mother.
Yeah, right.
We can think later on. Because if you remove everything, no chance of biological mother. If she sorry, I was not there. So how old she is?
27.
Oh, 27. Oh, I was thinking of 16. No, 16 is too long to get to be married. And then.
No, she's trying for pregnancy for around 10 years.
Okay. In that case, mind.
So we want to know comment from Professor Omita Maheshwari, madam.
Okay.
Omita was disconnected. Did she join?
Yes. She joined.
Yes, Omita.
Sorry, I mean, that has been really, after yesterday's cyclone, we have very poor internet, intermittently it's going. I missed the whole discussion.
Shishita, go through the from the specimen and just quick. Shishita.
Amita, there's a query about whether we should do any IHC to confirm whether it's germinoma or clear cell.
She left from that side.
It's okay. So if we have some doubt, then okay. So the final HPR is clear cell carcinoma.
Yes. Both were HPR only, no?
Yes, both HPR. Right. Yeah.
Each time it has been two different diagnoses. So what is the role of IHC?
IHC definitely. So we should do IHC.
She has advised for IHC, because today evening we have received the report.
And then just the omentum which was adherent to the tumor was metastatic, and the rest of the omentum was healthy. So their pathologist tells that it's a stage 1C and not 3C. So that's the contention here.
Yeah, so I think that adhesion could be because of biopsy there was breach in capsule and there was a biopsy taken. Yes. But if there is disease on omentum, then I think we will label it as stage 3 only, not stage 1C. The only thing is, if actually there was background endometriosis, clear cell is more, you know, of course, still could be a dysgerminoma, but with background endometriosis, there is a possibility of clear cell carcinoma.
But there was no endometriosis at all.
Okay, there was no endometriosis at all. Okay. So,
she disconnected again, probably. Sushmita?
Yes, ma'am.
This next.
So already answered question. Yes. So what will be her adjuvant treatment? Come on, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah. Please go ahead. Why we?
Yes. What will be her adjuvant treatment? Her question is now that.
Okay. I think because it's a stage 3C now, so we have all agreed that it's a stage 3C. Unfortunately, yes. We don't agree with the pathologist. Yes. So I think she needs a full course of paclitaxel, 6 cycles of paclitaxel adjuvant therapy.
Yes. Next, Sushmita, next.
So, in NCCN guidelines says ovarian clear cell carcinoma is high-grade tumor diagnosed postoperatively, and primary treatment is completion surgery with comprehensive staging followed by adjuvant treatment. Fertility sparing is not recommended in stage 1A to 1C clear cell carcinoma. Fertility sparing under observation or monitoring is considered in unilateral clear cell borderline tumor. So, Bhagalakshmi, ma'am. Do you have anything?
Sorry?
Do you agree or disagree? Fertility sparing is not recommended.
Yes, not recommended.
Yes. Because cervical clear cell carcinoma of the ovary is a high-grade tumor. And so once there is recurrence, we really, it's a recurrent disease, so difficult to treat. And so I think we can think of other fertility sparing methods like oocyte preservation, embryo preservation, and all those things. And then give her a good quality of life rather than a fertility.
Amita, ma'am?
She's again disconnected.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I totally agree with Bhagyalakshmi Nayak. And because from the very beginning, we are telling here is that there is no role of fertility sparing surgery. Even if stage, as per NCCN guideline, they say stage 1A also, there is no indications of going for the fertility sparing. So in the particular case, we should not go for fertility sparing. Rather, we should go for revision staging.
So, Shana, madam?
Yes.
So,
this one question to Dr. Sushmita. What is the IHC you did to confirm that it's a clear cell and not dysgerminoma?
Madam Adria.
Yeah.
Hello.
Adria, yeah. What I see.
I read one. Okay.
Adria.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. So, Bhagalakshmi, ma'am.
Yes.
Right now, we should go for completion surgery.
Yes, I think. You have to counsel her that otherwise she'll be sitting on a palm. So, yes. After the completion of chemotherapy, she'll recur again.
Yes. I want a comment from Amita, ma'am.
She's disconnected again.
So, madam, Shana, madam.
Yes.
We will go for completion surgery.
Yes. Next. Yeah. Okay.
So, thanks.
Thank you.
Yes.
Dr. Shana, can I ask one question for this lady?
Yes.
because you know, you have a lot of esteemed faculties. I mean, this lady, you have gone through the total clearance after the chemotherapy, right? She's only 37 years old.
27.
Now,
27.
Okay, fine. So definitely you have given her chemotherapy, you have removed all the things, she'll suffer from, I mean, loss of sexuality, libido, psychological upset, feeling isolated. So what are you doing? What are you going to do for this lady to improve the quality of life of this woman?
HRT.
Thank you.
I think Zinat, HRT.
Well, I think HRT, I mean, let me listen from the faculties,
yes, okay,
over the webinar. Then probably I could have some, yes, comment.
Yeah, so very difficult to advocate HRT in the particular case for at least for 1 to 2 years. The common is that you can go for this alternative therapy in terms of Jugo, all these things. Then we can go for some non-specific drugs, and this will help her at least for 1 to 2 years. Otherwise, there is chance of recurrence if you can give HRT or this because estrogen may be the some factor here. So we do not give HRT in particular case for at least 1 to 2 years.
Yeah, I was telling about non-pharmacological, like,
yeah,
non-pharmacological,
yeah, yes,
hormone,
yes, we can give
other non-pharmacological,
either either alternative drugs or Jogo, etc. And
yes,
some we can go do that. It will be better.
Yes, yes.
Well, can I comment one comment, please?
Yes,
can I,
yes,
do that?
Yes, yes, madam. Yes, madam. Can go.
Well, actually, you're on the right track, but I am wondering that as she has having the ovarian cancer, so maybe we need to go through details, history, whether she has got any other possibility in her family, like Lynch 1, Lynch 2, we don't know exactly. And then, oh, what about her breast? We don't know about that, though we can do the mammograph. So in that case, estrogen containing, our progesterone is a main culprit for the breast cancer. So we have to avoid those things. Yeah. But there are other hormones we can prescribe. And regarding the sexuality, definitely she will suffer from loss of libido, all these things. Probably testosterone can be added. That is very helpful for at least 6 months for her. And if it doesn't act, then probably you can go for the alternative, you know, sex therapies. And the bone marrow depression is the most important concern regarding this bilateral oophorectomy. So this lady, definitely she has to go for the BMD estimation. And we have to take all the precaution to prevent the progressive osteoporosis. Even we have to start calcium, I know, if MRA, yeah, that is very important. And we have to also look at that she should not suffer from vulvovaginal atrophy, and she should have psychological boosting up. Thank you very much.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ushmita, your patient, go to for your next case. Shmita?
Yes, ma'am.
Next question, please.
So I'm for the second case. She's 26 years, unmarried, attended to our OPD on December 2020 with complaint of abdominal lump for 3 to 4 months. Her father died of pancreatic cancer and mother died of breast cancer. She had no bowel habit alteration. On gene examination, her ECOG was 2, vitals were normal and breasts were normal. But abdominally, ascites was absent and a firm mass about 15 into 15 centimeter in abdominal pelvic area. But rectally, a solid mass felt higher. So the mass was 16 into 18 centimeter, but no ascites, no lymphadenopathy, but there were multiple as well in the liver. Regarding her tumor markers, CA120 by 133, CA19.9 was raised, 596 international unit per ml, and LDH was raised. Chest X-ray was normal. So regarding her family history, which genetic tests to be done? Bhagyalakshmi, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. is, I think, looking at the family history, we first have to do the BRCA testing of this woman, in case it's available and it's affordable, because I think this is the most important factor, because she already had a breast cancer in the family and pancreatic cancer also in the family. And here also, again, we can see that 19.9 is also very high, which is again, which is again a marker of BRCA positive malignancies. And I think that's the most important test I would advise her.
Giri sir?
Yes, I agree to it. If at all possible, we can go for MLH. MMR testing can be done here, but there is nothing to do with this colonic is not there. So perhaps this BRCA testing is a must. If you can afford, of course.
So how to proceed, sir, with this case? CA19-9 is raised.
Sometimes it is raised.
CT scan, it is 16 into 18 centimeter mass.
Yeah. So.
And more than that, she has multiple liver as well.
Yeah.
So it's already presenting with a very advanced stage.
So you should exclude liver met. You should exclude liver met first by doing at least FNA, all these things. Then if liver is not malignant or there is no metastatic, we can go for surgery. So have you excluded liver met?
Yeah. So endoscopy and colonoscopy done, and it both were normal. Ultrasound of breast, normal. Poor biopsy of the right adnexal mass came as serous borderline tumor, and FNAC of liver as well came as metastatic adenocarcinoma. So anything more to be done?
Perhaps nothing more.
So I think it's very difficult to correlate, because a borderline tumor metastasizing to the liver is very, very rare. I think it's too uncommon that a borderline tumor would metastasize to
So it must be serous carcinoma, ovary. So borderline tumor, it has come out to some portion of it come out a borderline tumor.
Maybe coexistent borderline tumor somewhere.
So what should I go for? So we can think of going for repeat core biopsy, or we can go for chemotherapy.
Yes. Chemotherapy or repeat core?
No, because she already has a metastatic adenocarcinoma in the liver. So we can do some kind of IHC to confirm what is the type of the adenocarcinoma. What is the type of the tumor? So that we confirm, and so then we go ahead with chemotherapy. Or you can repeat a core biopsy from the adnexal mass.
Yes.
To confirm whether, in case we can take some multiple biopsies also to confirm, so that because in the same tumor we may be having, which is although not very common also, unlike the mucinous tumors in which we have an array of benign, borderline and malignancy in the same tumor. In serous, it's usually not the case. But still, because we have two things which are not matching, and the CA19.9 is so high, which is also more representative of a mucinous tumor, I think we can go ahead and do the biopsy again, or do some kind of IHC to confirm what is the type of the adenocarcinoma.
So she was placed to our tumor board.
From the liver, yes. Or you will go for the core biopsy repeat from the ovary, because we know if it is a metastasis, so metastatic site bear all the the features of the primary.
Yes.
So it is we could to do the core from the liver rather than going to the because as it is a metastasis, we are confirmed. So I would go for a core from the liver to do a IHC if I plan to look for the type.
Yes, so all are optional. Because the other thing is that when you get a serous borderline tumor in the ovary, so whether we are correct in going ahead with chemotherapy, so that's again an issue.
Yes, that's why I want to go to the core from the liver, do the IHC and confirm that yes, it is coming from the ovary, so I confirm it is stage 4, then I go for the chemotherapy.
Yes.
So now after giving chemotherapy, primary pathology will be gone somewhere. we may miss the primary pathology. So why not go from primary if you can go to do a core biopsy or review this primary biopsy elsewhere or with this same pathologist, that our two pathology findings are different. So perhaps we can get the primary tissues, the tissue origin, we can get better. So perhaps we can get from primary side, we can get either core biopsy repeat, or we can review that core biopsy elsewhere. It will be better for us.
Okay, so go ahead. What happened after chemotherapy?
She received 3 cycles chemotherapy with paclitaxel and carboplatin up to 21st March 2021. After completing 3 chemo cycles, she came to us, and on general examination, she was moderately anemic, breasts and thyroid normal. Her abdominally, the mass became larger, that is 20 into 20 centimeters in the abdomen with restricted mobility. Rectovaginally, the mass fell through anterior rectal wall. So, regarding her tumor markers, CA 19.9 became double up, but her LGPT was normal.
And what about the liver lesions?
Liver lesion remains
bigger.
Bigger.
No, they have become bigger.
Bigger. And the mass, parabdominally mass remains the same, 17 to 17 centimeter.
So you have to review the diagnosis now.
So she underwent laparotomy on 26th April. Paraoperative findings were no ascites and no.
You are muted.
Unmute. You have muted yourself, Sushmita.
So she underwent laparotomy on 26th April. Paraoperative findings were there was no ascites and no deposit anywhere on abdominopelvic peritoneum. A large mass, about 20 into 80 centimeter, arising from right ovary, multilobulated, adherent with uterus and gut wall. Left ovary apparently normal looking. Liver was hard and nodular, fixed with anterior abdominal wall, but no lymphadenopathy. So total abdominal hysterectomy with bilateral sulfemeningophorectomy was done.
Yes. Next.
It is not working. So, do you think the surgery suffice or appendectomy is to be included?
Yes, you could have added appendectomy because we do not know, might be we are dealing with mucinous carcinoma in this particular case. Perhaps you could have done it, but it's not mandatory.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, did you look at the appendix? Have you seen the appendix, whether it was normal or not?
It was normal looking.
Okay, then. And what was the CEA levels?
CA
I think was not done.
It was always 19.9.
Usually
CA not done.
Initially it was done.
Okay. Do you think it should be repeated? CA?
Yeah, we can repeat. We can guess that also arises. Because 19.9 is definitely a marker of mucinous or maybe pancreatic or some other cancer. Yes. So we should have repeated anyway. That was the issue. And appendix, I am not very sure whether it would have added anything more. But then we have left behind all the liver lesions. We have done a THPSO omentectomy, and the only hope for this is that we'll reach a final diagnosis about what could be the tumor.
Yes.
And maybe just do some kind of tumor debulking in case it would help in chemotherapy. Yes.
Next.
I don't know how we are going to help the patient.
So her final histopathology report is papillary serous cyst adenocarcinoma high grade in both ovaries.
Okay, so that fits into our criteria of BRCA mutations.
Yeah, and postoperatively her CA 19.9 decreasing. How to explain, ma'am?
Amita Mahashri, ma'am, please. Sushmita.
Amita is there?
Yes. She again joined.
Oh, I'm very intermittently there.
Okay, you just.
So, other thing is whether this tumor was extensively studied on histopathology. Was it a mixed kind of tumor? Rarely you may have a combination of mucinous and serous. And again, like CA125, CA199 also somewhat a non-specific marker. So it could be elevated. And she also had liver disease, I guess. I again made part of it. So CA99, liver metastasis. So that I don't know whether that can cause increase in CA19.9.
No, Amita, it has reduced. It was some 1300 or something. It has come down to 269.
Okay.
After surgery.
Surgery. Yeah.
Okay. So I think we have to, because if masses were big, we have to be sure that there was no other component. Generally, like even endometrioid component or a clear cell or mucinous can cause elevation CA19.9. So we have seen endometrioid adenocarcinoma also can have elevated CA19.9.
The seromucinous varieties.
Yeah, seromucinous type of carcinoma or mixed carcinoma.
Okay, so now they have done a TH, BSO and omentectomy, but the liver mets are left behind. So how do we go about?
How many liver mets?
Big mets. Can you go back on the slides?
Yeah.
Multiple liver met.
Yes, yes. Here you can see the liver met. 2-3
minimum. 3-4.
Chemo or pre-chemo?
Post chemo.
After chemotherapy, yeah.
The mass grew in size and the liver mets too grew in size after 3 cycles of paclitaxel.
Okay.
So what could be the diagnosis? Because after chemotherapy, the tumor has grown in size. And so they removed the tumors and the liver mets were there. And the only thing which has come down is CA19.9.
But is the diagnosis primary papillary serous adenocarcinoma is confirmed? Is it based on IHC? Have we done WT1 and taxate at least? And CK7? Also.
Sushmita?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you get back to your pathologist about the tumor marker?
Madam, just IHC, has done. We are planning for doing immunohistochemistry.
Yeah, we need to do immunohistochemistry.
So, Amita, my comment is that whatever we do, we should do from the both the sides. Because we need to take a core from the liver also. And because, to justify all these things with such a clean abdomen, with such a huge tumor, I mean, it doesn't go like this again with multiple metastasis in the liver. And CA99 coming down after the surgery. I mean, there are so many questions.
At the end, you know, oncology is all about pathology. So we really need to have good pathologists who can give.
Really, I mean, give us the missing link here.
Yeah.
And we take all the credit.
No, then they all oncologists, pathologists, they will shoot us.
Madam.
Yes.
My panelists and my madam. The patient presented with adverse disease with a huge mass, but there was no ascites. Is it common?
Yes.
Yeah, it can happen that way. It can happen, especially if it is non-serous epithelial ovarian cancer.
But it is high-grade serous, ma'am.
And that's what we are discussing. We should be sure, we need to have proper immunohistochemistry on tissue to be sure that it is one of those primary ovarian and serous.
And cut section, do we have any pictures?
In favor of serous. And CA19.9 also doesn't go in favor of serous, but the metastasis goes in favor of serous. So,
there is no history of cholecystectomy in this patient, no, because primary gallbladder also is very papillary kind of tumor, and CA19.9 liver mets, all that can happen. So any history of cholecystectomy?
No, no.
No, but she had a history of pancreatic CA and breast cancer in the family.
Family, yeah.
Okay.
So
and
that's
she's only 37 years.
Work with both the tissue. From the liver, because it may be a second pathology. I mean, it is possible that because the very feature of the paraoperative findings doesn't really go, I don't know, I mean, with the serous.
Yeah, so the ovarian tumor may be something else and the liver met may be something else.
Maybe. Because, you know, sometimes the GI origin metastasis to the liver, but we have missed the primary. It can happen. It happens.
Yeah. Did we do upper GI endoscopy here?
Yeah. It is not normal.
It is normal.
It's normal.
Actually, I have seen this sort of thing with endometrioid ovarian cancer. You know, huge masses without ascites and with liver mets. Clear cell endometrioid, they may have this kind of picture. Not see with serous, pure serous, it is rare.
So it is histopathology is again the issue. They will kill us.
Mucinous such metastasis, Amita?
No, sorry?
Mucinous with such metastasis?
Yeah, doesn't fit, no?
I mean, I'm just asking. Hello? Do you have any experience of such? Is there any experience of so many metastases with mucinous because the CA19-9 and the feature goes favor of mucinous? Let us, for argument's sake, think it is a mucinous. Can we justify the metastasis of the liver with mucinous?
All right. We think, yes, that the liver during surgery, the liver was hard, fixed, and it was like a cirrhotic liver.
Liver lesion is something else.
Yes, I think it is different pathology because the liver was.
So that is why the 19.9 was so raised. Because
yes,
of the liver
it was just like a cirrhotic liver. Just it was hard, fixed, and nodular. Whole liver was nodular.
So that was I was telling that, I mean, we need to deal with both the tissue, not only the ovarian tissue.
Yes, yes.
We need to take a core biopsy from the liver, work on that for histopathology and IHC, and it may be two pathology. But my question was to Bhagyalakshmi and Dr. Giri and Amita, that for not for this case, I mean, if it is a mucinous, we know it metastasized. Is there any, can we see something like this in mucinous? Is it possible?
Sir, mucinous carcinoma are very, very rare carcinoma in ovary. And that too, with a limited disease, metastasis to liver is again, I don't think it is so common.
Yeah, but the first CT scan plate looks like a mucinous tumor only.
But mucinous tumor without ascites going to liver is becomes I have not seen. Rather serous tumor going to liver is common. And liver diseases which is there, yes, might be the something different than the ovarian disease. Might be, we do not know. But again, we have to, as sir told, so we have to go for a IC of this liver disease, liver metastasis disease, then we can think of what is there. And perhaps during surgery, you could have palpated other organs like pancreas, gallbladder, and perhaps you could have got something which is just occult diseases are there, which might have caused the metastasis. Perhaps, what is the status of pancreas?
Situation, what we see, that we don't see it image, but paroperatively we find the pancreas. Because pancreas, it is not always very clear in image. But paroperatively, I mean, sometimes we find there was some lesion which caused this type of thing. I mean, it may be another thing. I mean, I am still convinced that the liver is from GI.
All probabilities.
GI origin.
Or maybe, is it the 19.9 could be raised also in hepatocellular carcinoma?
Possible. I mean, something and GI origin should be there because with this ovarian mass and these multiple metastases, with this paroperative findings, I don't know. I mean, it doesn't fit.
Doesn't match.
Kamal, is there any history of taking prototype inhibitor for a longer period?
Sorry?
Is there any history of taking proton pump inhibitors for a longer period?
Maybe, sir.
If you took proton pump inhibitors for a longer period, that can create this problem.
Sir, how does that do that? How does proton pump inhibitors?
Are you talking about the liver lesion for long term proton pump inhibitors, sir?
Proton pump inhibitors has a late side effect creating these things. They impact. They bring change in the stomach, also pancreas, and even liver also. That may be one of possibilities.
Okay, so the take-home message from here is that we will go for the immunohistochemistry, and both from this tissue and also from the liver tissue. Yeah. Yep.
Four
yes.
biopsies yes. from yes. liver and
four types of liver. Yeah. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so
much. My question: if it comes to be primary papillary serous carcinoma, now what are the adjuvant therapy? The primary therapy didn't help. The NSAID didn't help. Now the question of giving the adjuvant therapy is difficult now. If it comes to be primary papillary serous adenocarcinoma high grade, so it becomes a difficult task now.
No, sir. I think we are missing something somewhere. Because if it would have been high-grade serous, it would have responded to the chemotherapy.
Yes, that's true. It should have responded sometimes.
Yes.
So we'll go for the IA. So you would revise the diagnosis now.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thanks all for patient sharing.
Stop your slide share. Yeah.
Thank you,
Sushmita,
and all the presenters.
Yeah, fantastic presentation.
Thank you, sir, and thank you all the faculties and the participants for your participation. Now the time of the poll questions again. All the participants are requested for poll voting. Shorna, please. So the poll questions, Shorna. Yes. Now it is 30-second part question. Hard question, hard. Okay, stop the poll for sharing. And now I request our scientific secretary, Dr. A.P.M. Kamal Uthilbhai, for comment and for the vote of thanks for the faculties and all to the participants.
So thank you, Shahana. It was a very wonderful session. Even I was not in the beginning, but thanks to all the presenter first, because very nice case was selected and presented. And every case was head scratching. And thanks to all the foreign faculties for their wonderful support. And at one stage, I saw it reached 140 plus participation. And I see many overseas participation was there. So thanks to all of them for their continuous support, which is making this effort successful. And thanks to our president, Professor Heiser, to be with us and encourage us. And not but the least, congrats to Shahana and her team who is carrying this forward. And I'm sure this endeavor will continue, and as long as our participants find it helpful, we will continue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kamalbhai, for your nice comment. Now I request our chairperson and president of the Oncology Club for his comment and conclude the session. Before that, I request Dr. Fatima Shorna to show the poll winners.
Swarna, please.
So, Shakshi is from India, I'm sure.
Yes. Other two, I will see.
Okay, Shahana.
Next. Okay. Thank you, Shorna. Hi, sir, please.
Okay. Thank you, Shahana, and everybody. It was a very nice session. I'm very happy that the participants have finished. Question and session discussion. Heartfelt thanks to particularly to the faculties from India, Amita Maheshwari, Shailesh Singh, and Sukhil Kumar Giri, and also Dr. Avija. He's taking great interest in that endeavor. My great thanks to the presenters, their present papers very nicely. Happy that we continue this thing, and from behalf of Bombology Club and myself, I express our greatest thanks and gratitude to all of you. Thank you all very much.
Thanks to all the participants, that we invite you all for another session and another in the next week, that next Tuesday, that is 25th May. There is the whole around 2.5 hour session for the endometrial carcinoma. So all the participants are requested to participate in their sessions, and you request and you please invite your and convey the message to other your friends and colleagues to join in their sessions. So hope we will enjoy the next week's session. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Shana. Thank you, Dr. Kamal. Good night, sir.